Welcome everybody to this tutorial. Today I will open up a chapter on reverse shells. Now let me begin by just explaining what they are in general. Basically, a reverse shell would be something that you put a piece of code that you would place on a device, namely on a computer, but you can also place it on a phone or a pretty much smartphone like an Android device or an iPhone or something of a kind. And then you are able to control such devices remotely from the location of your choice. Now, to do this over the internet, it's a little bit trickier, and you would have to combine several things what we have learned thus far. For example, you would have to first, if you had a computer at home, and if you didn't have a VPN with a static IP, you would need to configure your own router. Well, actually, it's not that hard. All you would need to do is put an IP address of your computer. So ifconfig. You can also do it. You can also use the IP of a virtual machine, no problems, if it's in the bridged mode, as I've showed you. And you would need to find an option DMZ, so demilitarized zone, as it is usually referred to. And you would basically put this IP address. Keep in mind if it changes that you need to put it back in, that you need to change the DMZ as well. I've decided not to show you how to do this on a router because I could only show you how to do it on my own router, and there are various routers out there, but look, it's pretty simple. Just open up your web interface of a router and find DMZ. So DMZ. There's usually just one option, one field. You can only put one IP address and just type in this IP address, and then you will be able to use your public IP address, which you can get by typing in your favorite search engine, what is my IP? Then get that public IP address, and you can use that IP address as a listener for all the reverse shells you create. Now, there are several approaches here in terms of deployment and creation of a reverse shell. To create them, you can either code it yourself, which is a preferable way, primarily because the reverse shells that you can generate automatically can be detected by antiviruses, and that's not what you really want. You want something that's undetectable. But for the time being, coding a reverse shell on your own, I can tell you it's not a simple task, especially when you need to do hex dumps to avoid privileges and stuff of a kind, to avoid firewall detection. But look, basically, if you code it yourself, it's probably going to be something simple. It's going to be far away from professional. It's going to be bad. Let's face the reality of things. However, because it's bad, because it's unprofessional, because it doesn't contain any complex functions, because it doesn't contain the usual patterns that a pro reverse shell would contain, it is not that likely to be detected by antiviruses. So that's a big plus for you. So if you can even code the basic reverse shells, just look it up on the net. I'm not going to get into that because that would be a separate course for itself, a programming course. If you can code even the basic reverse shells, you stand a very good chance of not getting detected, primarily because your reverse shells will be noobish. And that's a good thing. That can be a good thing, actually. Anyway, it is unlikely that you will pass the detection by an automatically generated reverse shell on a fully updated system. So keep that in mind. You need to look for a system that doesn't have the latest updates, that is behind in such a sense, and then you have a very good chance of passing with an automated reverse shell. The tool for, or the framework for creating reverse shells is Metasploit. Metasploit is a fantastic framework used by pentesters all around the world. Now, professionals use a paid version, a pro version, which costs, I've remember a long time ago, I knew the exact price, but it doesn't really matter. It was around $5,000, so 5K per license per a month. That costs quite a bit. Things might have changed in the meantime. It's been a while since I checked those prices out, but I'm just trying to make a point that even though the pen testing companies are paying such prices and they're not paying it for a single license, usually they're paying for more than one, even though the program is open source, if the program is open source, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's free of charge. Of course, we will be using a free of charge version. Primarily, you don't have a GUI interface there, you have to do everything via terminal. So that's kind of a downside for some, but not to the fullest of extents. And there are some features that are available only for the pro version. However, if you feel like paying 5K per month, just go over on the net, type in Metasploit in the search engine, and your first results should be their official website. Anyway, without further ado, we're gonna get into Metasploit immediately. I'm gonna go ahead and clear the screen, and we will use it to generate a script, and we will also use it as a listener. Now, Metasploit, I mean, you can run it just by default in Kali without actually doing any sort of configuration of whatsoever, but I don't recommend it primarily because you can speed up pretty much everything by just doing a few simple things. So go ahead and type in service. We will give Metasploit framework a database to use, and if it uses a database, it is faster. So type in postage SQL start. You will need to start postage SQL. It's already running for me. I can just type in status. And there you go, it says running clusters. Anyway, go ahead and clear the screen. Type in service Metasploit start. And this should start the Metasploit, this should start this Metasploit service as well. I'm gonna type in status. And okay, so there are a few things that will start up once you type in service Metasploit start. Anyway, go ahead and clear the screen, type in MSF console, press enter. And I gotta warn you, this is gonna take a while actually to start. Primarily because Metasploit is pretty big, it has a lot of things in it, and it takes a while on a virtual machine to actually start, primarily because of the limited resources. Let me just go ahead and open up another terminal and type in MSF update. Is this it? Excellent. So if you type in MSF update on an root in a root terminal, it will update the Metasploit framework. I would suggest to do this as often as possible. It says, note, expect weekly or weekish updates using this method. So, I mean, if they issue weekly updates, you should definitely consider updating it at least twice a week just to be sure, just to make sure that you have those latest updates readily available at hand. Now this here where it says username, security, password, blank, this is nothing. This is a banner. Don't let that confuse you. Let me just show you banner. You see it changes and then it changes again. I don't know why, but a lot of these banners are actually cows. There is a logic to it, but I'm gonna let you actually figure that one out. I'm pretty sure I knew that a while ago, but doesn't really matter. So a cow, this one, Metasploit, a cow again, cow again, this sign, cow again. So there we go. You can just keep on typing in banner and it's gonna give you different banners. I do believe that every time you start Metasploit, it does actually give you a different banner. Now, go ahead and type in help just to see a ton load of options that you have here that you can use. So if you, and the usage of commands is pretty much the same as in a Linux shell, so don't worry about it. What you have used thus far, you can use here. You see, I have change directory, okay, for change of banner back. Now, instead of using cd space dot dot, you would use back to exit a current payload or exploit or whatever. Anyway, apparently you can even change colors. I'm not gonna do that now. Those are all aesthetics, it doesn't matter. So you have connected it, exit completely. That's how you quit MSF payload, MSF console. You got a lot of things down here, so help for help menus, and you usually would use space dash H for commands here, just like you would use in a Linux shell as well, and it would give you a list of options. Info, it displays info about modules. We'll soon get into that. You can also say jobs, because in MSF, in Metasploit, you can issue several jobs, and they can all run in the background, and you can list them, and then you can summon them into foreground as well to see what is going on to give you real-time updates. So that's not a bad idea. Now you might get a one. There is an option that goes like this: search. Now, if you type in search, and if it there is a yellow flag telling you that you are not connected to a database after all that we did thus far. Well, we didn't do much. We just started two services basically. We have given Metasploit a database to use. Just go ahead and type in DB rebuild cache, the one that I'm selecting now. If that doesn't work, go ahead and exit Metasploit, reset the computer, and repeat the steps. See if that helps you out. If it doesn't help you out, come back on Udemy, post it in the discussions, and I'll see what I can do. But just try resetting it a couple of times, resetting Metasploit, resetting PostgreSQL, and reboot the system. Don't know why sometimes it breaks. I don't know. It's a free version, it's open source, and it's fantastic, but of course it's not perfect. So you have to work with me here and adapt a little bit. Anyway, we will use some of these commands, but I wanted you to have a look at them and just know how to summon them. I would strongly recommend that you go at least through some of them, through at least a couple of more that we are going to use today. Just to familiarize yourself with a bit of extra information, as Metasploit is huge. I mean, it is gigantic. There are so many things in it, there are so many exploits, there are so many modules, there's so many payloads. It is ridiculous. So let me just banner. Okay, so there are 14,000 here. 1400 there, 900 here, 244 here, 363, 378. I think it sums up around 3K or something of a kind, not sure. But 3000 things to use in general is a pretty large number. Plus, Metasploit also supports scripting. You can write your own scripts that you can use as payloads and deploy them. It's just ridiculous how many options it possesses. We're going to go through some of them today, but I would strongly recommend that you keep on exploring and see what else you can do with them out of 3,000 things basically that are there. Something is bound to work. So you have 1,443 exploits that you can attempt on various systems. The exploits come with payloads and auxiliary come without payloads. And if you just keep on trying, something is bound to work. I mean, they pretty much got an exploit for every single piece of code that was ever created out there. Well, maybe not like that, but you get the idea, you get what I'm saying. Okay, so let's just clear it one more time. I like to keep it neat. And now today we're gonna actually generate an automatic reverse shell for Windows 8.1. How you deploy it is up to you. You have the benefit of the previous tutorials of me showing you a couple of things with the DNS and with Wi-Fi and with all of that, how you can redirect the users, how you can reroute their traffic, how you can manipulate it, and you can use some of those methods. Actually, you can use almost all of them to actually inject this sort of code onto your victim's computer. Well, not to inject it, but actually to trick the user into downloading it and into running it. You can even force it by denying connection or by, I don't know, saying that it's a new security feature of a browser or something of a kind once the user is redirected to your website. Because if you alter the DNS settings, you can basically say whenever the user opens up a browser and browses for any website, redirect him here. And you can just say, I don't know, Firefox or Internet Explorer requires this piece of code as a security update. You need to install, you just need to click here to install it, and they click there and they install it. Guess what? You have a reverse shell back to them. It's not really that difficult. It's not really that hard. Play around with it and see how it works out for you. Benefits can be numerous. Anyway, we have, before I actually go ahead and start generating the reverse shells, you also have an option search, which you are going to probably be using extensively. Let's just do space dash h, and here you have, I don't know, various arguments it can pass. Here is how it actually looks like, how the example of a search option of the search command. So we'll just go ahead and type in search. I like to use name. And what shall we use with name? Let's say I want meter, which is a reverse. Oh yeah, my famous typing, which is a listener. It's a session that you can open. If I got some of the terminology wrong, feel free to hang me in the discussion section. I'll be more than happy to accept any reviews or criticism. Nobody's perfect. But anyway, here you go. You have these payloads. What else do we got? Okay, so yep, there we go. These are a bit neater here. It says payload for Android. I've only said that I want meterpreter, and here it's usually reverse TCP blind, TCP reverse HTTP reverse HTTPS, so you can even encrypt the traffic. You see, there was one for Android, for BSD out of all operating systems. There's Java one. Java one will work on pretty much anything that has Java installed on it, which is pretty much anything these days. You even got ones for Linux via PHP. PHP will work on pretty much anything out there as well. Python, well, if they have it installed, sure. If not, then not. There we go. So there is a payload for Windows interpreter, and then you have different variants of it, different types. I have a specific one in mind that I plan to use today, but feel free to take a look at these. You have descriptions here. You have their rating here. It can be poor, normal, and excellent. I think those three parameters apply. And then you have a description here of what it actually does. A brief description of how it is done. Anyway, let's just go ahead and clear the screen. Now that you have some of the basic options in the follow-up tutorial, I'm gonna come back and actually generate a reverse shell and see how it works. There will be a demo. Until then, I bid you farewell.